Hello and welcome to the next part of my LEGO Powered Up tutorial that you can use for Powered Up, Control Plus and LEGO Boost. Today we want to check a new feature or an additional feature of the LEGO Boost color and distance sensor because it's able to control power functions, because it's possible to control power functions with the sensor. To be more precise, the sensor can emit infrared signals, and these signals can be used to control power functions IR receivers. So you can use this sensor as a remote for this receiver, and you can plug this sensor into a hub that can be programmed. So in the end, you can program power functions, but you need the sensor and a hub, a powered up hub in your model. Power functions isn't available anymore. It's discontinued, but maybe you've still got a few power functions elements. And today I'll tell you how to use it or how to control power functions with the LEGO Boost color and distance sensor. And sadly, at the moment of recording this video, there's no simple solution, but it's possible nonetheless. There are two blocks that we have to use. The first one is this block. It changes the mode of the color and distance sensor. Normally you have modes to read the color, a mode to read the distance and stuff like that. And then we have the seventh mode that can be used to control power functions. This block has been executed once for the sensor to be switched to mode 7, and then again if you switch it to another mode to read a distance or something like that. And then we have one command to send the actual power functions command. This command has four inputs, the port of the sensor, and three more inputs, and we will check what they mean now. LEGO Power Functions uses an infrared protocol that's documented at this page. I will link it in the video description. And here we can get the numbers that we need to control this block. We can scroll down a bit. Most of the stuff from this protocol can be skipped, but we will have to talk about how a power function's infrared signal looks like. This is the binary representation. I hope that you know what a binary number is or what a bit is. A bit can be either 0 or 1, or true or false, depending on how you interpret it. And maybe you've heard of a byte, which consists of 8-bit, so you can store 8-bit values in a byte. And then we have, in this case, a nibble. A nibble basically consists of 4-bit, so it's half the length of a byte. And this is how a power functions command looks. All of these columns are bits, more or less. And first we have a start condition. We won't have to care about that. Then we have the first nibble that consists of 4-bit. The actual value or the actual purpose of the bit is explained below. We will come to that. Then we have the second nibble that consists of 4-bit. And then we have the third nibble that consists of 4-bit as well. Last we have the checksum. But we won't care about that because the sensor can calculate it on its own. And last we have the stop condition that's calculated automatically as well. So we will only have to care about these three nibbles. Here's a basic explanation of how it works, but the interesting part, or the interesting stuff, starts here. And maybe to give an overview, this block has three inputs, three numbers, and there are these three nibbles. Here you can see that one input is A. That's because the values are hexadecimal. One hexadecimal number can have a number between 0 and 16, and it's basically one nibble. One hexadecimal number is one nibble. So the first nibble is this number, the second nibble is this number, and the third nibble is this number. Yes, it's a letter, but it's hexadecimal. We will get to that. So There are different modes with different behaviors, and you will have to think about which mode you want to use. You will skip the extended mode. You can read this stuff if you're interested in it, but I won't cover it. Then there's the combo direct mode, which is used in the normal power functions remote controls and in the LEGO Mindstorms EV3 infrared remote. It's basically one command that can control if the motors turn forwards with full power, backwards, or stop. And we can control both ports at the same time with one command. Also, this mode has a timeout, which means that after, I think, 1.2 seconds, the motor stops if no new command is received. Now you might think that you have to send these commands all the time, and that's basically true, but the current distance sensor repeats commands that have a timeout on their own, so we won't have to care about the timeout. We will only have to send the command once to the current distance sensor, and then it will do the rest for us. Next, we have the single output mode. Here we can control one output with one command. It's used in the train remote. And we have the combo PWM mode, which controls two motors in PWM, but this has a timeout. The single output mode has no timeout except for exceptions. But let's get to the simplest mode, to the combo direct mode. I will explain that in this part of the tutorial. And in the next part, we will write a program to remote control the track racer. But let's start here. So we have to care about three nibbles. The first one begins with toggle, but if we read the text above, toggle bit is not verified on receiver, so we won't have to care about that. Next, we have an escape bit, which is zero, so we can assume that it's zero as well. So far we have two zeros, and then we have the channel. We have two bits for the channel. 00 would be channel 1. You can control the channel with the orange slider at the infrared receiver. With the slider, here you can select channel 1 to 4, and they're represented by 0 to 3, or in binary. Channel 1 is 00, channel 2 is 01, channel 3 is 10, and channel 4 is 11. So we have the first nibble. It's basically the channel. My receiver will be on channel 0, so the first nibble is 0. And then we have to convert this binary value, which consists of 4 zeros, to a hexadecimal value that we can input into this block. And this one is pretty simple. 4 zeros is hexadecimal 0 as well. So the first input for this block would be a 0. Next, we have the second nibble. Here we have an address bit. We can ignore that normally, except if you send special commands via the extended mode, but normally it's zero. So we assume that this is zero. Then we have two more zeros and a one for the mode. So the mode nibble, or the second nibble, is 0001, and that translates to 1 in hexadecimal. That means that we already got the second input, and that's 1. Now to the third input, or to the third nibble. These four bits are explained below. The first two bits are these four bits, and the second two bits are these four bits. So we can, with the first two bits, we can control the behavior of one motor. We can let it float, drive forward, drive backward, or brake. And then we have two bits for the second motor, and it has the same numbers. So if we want to drive both motors forwards, we can enter 01 and 01 for the second motor as well. And that would translate to 5 in hexadecimal. So in this case, our input for this block would be 015. But now let's check it out in the actual software. Here we are again. And first, a few words to the setup. I've got a powered up hub with a LEGO Boost color and distance sensor connected to it, to port A. The color and distance sensor can send infrared commands to the power functions receiver that is on channel 1, and it has both of these motors connected. So this sensor can remote control this receiver. There are a few things that you have to be aware of if you try this on your own. The sender should be in direct connection or in direct sight to the receiver so that you don't lose any packets or any commands. Anyways, let's write the program. I updated the Android device that I'm recording with, so I hope that everything works a bit better, but it's possible that small errors might appear, so we will see. This is a normal program without any content, and as I said before, first you have to put the sensor in the right mode. The right mode is 7, so I put it in 7. And then we can use this block to send infrared commands. You can find these blocks in the purple category. And first, we need a block to stop the motors, because it might happen that they don't do what we want, and then we want to stop them as fast as possible. For that, I usually write a simple stop command. In this case, we can simply put this to 1 because it's channel 0. 1 is for the mode, and the input is 0 for break. But we can basically copy the command and write the second one to move the motors. We use the same mode. We have to use the input 0 for channel 1. And here we can select the behavior of the motor, and that is 5. So both motors should turn forwards. So let's try it out. I can press on this start block to stop the program, or to stop the power functions communication, and on this block to start the motor. And we will only have to run this once, because then the sensor will repeat the command without any additional inputs. So let's try it out. I can press on this start block, and both motors start to turn, and they stop when I press this start block. Keep in mind that the screen capture has a bit of a delay compared to the camera footage. Anyways, that was it for this part. I think that in the next part, we will write our own remote control for the track tracer or for any other remote controlled power functions vehicle. So make sure to check that out if you're interested in that. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next part. Bye!